municipal year, all things being equal. First item is to check whether we've got any disclosable pecuniary and or any other relevant interest. Oh, yes, Caulfield. Sorry, I didn't work in yet.
Just in case it does apply, yeah. Actually, the governor of a school that is in the
PFI. Okay. Yeah. All right, good. Okay, any other people who have left the category now? Okay, thank you. Next item is the minutes. People content by some of those minutes as an accurate record? Yep, yeah. Okay. Oh, it is now working. There you go. Okay, you're going to have to wash your hands now. Thank you, Colin. I would like to adjust the agenda if that's if the committee's okay with that. Just conscious that someone has to be awake early, back for a medical appointment. So I'm going to deal with bringing PFI contracts up to the first item. Are people content if we do that?
Yeah.
Okay, so PFI is pages 69 to 76. You just follow that. And I think, David, you're going to introduce this item for us, are you?
Yes, Chair.
Oh, well, there you are. Okay. Let me just find the right page. Yeah, fine, contract. Okay, David, away you go. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. Now, this is something we haven't visited for a while. I understand you asked for this report to take stock of the financial position. So this report tends to do that. To save spending a lot of time on the scheme itself, and conscious there's only two or three of us left who would remember the original scheme, I haven't quite got a shed like Councillor Gilchrist, but I've been in the archive and I've found some photographs of the type of accommodation that was replaced in 2001 to 2004, and there's also a little case study there from 2004 which was to do with the new weatherhead and skills. So if anybody's interested, they're not part of the official papers, but they provide the background. I think that the PFI scheme had its origins in the late 1990s. It was the only way in town, the only show in town for securing that level of investment, and it involved nine schools. And it's interesting when we did the numbers, I'm involved with this in supporting the one remaining PFI manager we have as best I can. I got involved around contract signature. Currently about 34% of our secondary school pupils attend a PFI school. The contract runs till 2031. It's a unique contract. It was only the first or the second one in the country to group schemes together, which makes it complicated. Clearly, seven out of nine schools have either become trusts or academies, but the contract remains with the council. So there'll come a day in 2031 when the contract ends. The schools will get handed back to the council. There are handback standards for everything in terms of the remaining life of boilers and rooms and things like that. And in the blink of an eye, the council will then pass on those sites to the academies. There are currently 125-year leases in place that accommodate that. So there's a contract between the council and the PFI provider, and then there are sub-arrangements with the schools that become academies. So that's what will happen in 2031. The contract runs too late. I think there are two other PFI schools on the Wirral, the Ridgeway and Bedford Drive Primary. They're often referred to as the Michael Dove initiative because they were national PFI schemes to standard designs. And their PFI schemes between the government and the provider, but they only cover the buildings, they don't cover all the facilities management services. Whereas in the nine school contract, the much earlier contract, it covered the PFI provider provides all the things I've listed, like the catering and the cleaning and the caretaking and so on. But those two, Ridgeway and Bedford Drive, they are only the building. Foxfield was also rebuilt under the Michael Cove scheme, but because it was a special school, that was a capital allocation, straightforward capital. So this is about the nine. The figures at 4.1, I think, are what you're most interested in terms of the costs. The council receives around £5.5 million worth of additional grant every year to the government for PFI, and it will receive that every year until the contract finishes in 2031. So that was an incentive in the 1990s to make PFI work. It was very helpful. The schools pay another £7.9 million. That's the cost they pay for their facilities management services. And the council contributes it was more than that, but there was an opportunity a few years ago where we could delegate 2.3, I think it was 2.3 million schools money, schools budget money, to the PFI schools, and they agreed to pay that back. If we hadn't done that, we would have missed the opportunity to do it, and schools fought for each that. It was money that could be allocated to schools, it was delegated out to the PFI schools, and they paid that back. The balance is around the million, and that comes from council funding. Clearly against that, and I'm not arguing either way, but against that, you've got to set aside if the council had to go and borrow the 60, 70 million that was required to do all the work, and you've seen some photographs of it, clearly repaying the capital charges. And also we having to maintain those buildings, which would now be 15 years old. So and there's 200,000 in there for the city learning centres. Just as the PFI contract was being signed, the government of the day announced city learning centres. Two of them were on the PFI sites, one on the Wallasey School site and one at Hillbury. The third one was a ridge-rated, long, pointed building in Seacombe motorway. They were incorporated in the PFI contract because you couldn't really have a city learning centre sitting on a PFI site that wasn't part of the PFI legal agreement. And of course they used to generate income when they were working, and when they closed because it was the money, the funding ended, we have to put that in as well, the 200,000. That's mainly for the one on the Wallasey site. The one on the Hillbury site is now incorporated in the school, and the school have incorporated that, and they pay for the day-to-day maintenance of it. But they're part of the contract. And there's a paragraph in there in 5.1 about those. Again, there's an appropriate leasing arrangements. In terms of Kingsway, which I think was the other matter you were interested in, clearly we didn't take the decision to close Kingsway. The Northern Schools Trust took the decision in the summer of 17. And we argued strongly that the decision was taken too late, to be fair to the pupils and allow them to move on. And the Regional Schools Commissioner accepted that argument, and the schools kept open for a further year to allow a more ordered transition. The school then closed in August 2018. Since then, we sat down with the PFI company, and you'll see at 6.2, we had some sort of open thinking and said, right, what can we do? And there were eight options that they took away and discussed with the lenders and the various took various legal advice on the options. And the options ruled out were alternative use really, because the building in Kingsway sits in a floodplain, and to redevelop that land for anything else would be really, really problematic. We'd also have to buy our way out of the PFI contract, and the advice was that it would cost a lot of money even to look at the viability of that, let alone the millions and billions it would cost us to buy out of it. So the sensible way forward is alternative educational use, and that's what we are currently exploring with other schools. I gather there's some tentative discussions started with some special schools about relocation, but it is at an early stage. In the meanwhile, the building is secure. As a caretaker who has the job from heaven, because he has a school with no pupils in it, the place is clean, the gardens are maintained, everything is kept to a standard, the plant is run to make sure it works and everything. So the building is kept secure, and we have to continue to pay the charge. What we did was we had a discussion with the Education Funding Agency, and we said, look, we didn't close the school, so it's not fair that we have to pick up all the bill. And the debate went on for some considerable time, and in the end they agreed that they would give us some additional transitional funding to help that out. So I refer to that at 6.10. So they've actually given us some additional funding for this year and last year to ease the transition. And in fact, we just did the process now, signed the legal that school used the city learning centre because it's a detached building for their sixth form, and they really like that. And hopefully that's a basis of saying to the school community, these buildings have a future use. So I think that's where we are. I think that sets out the financial position. Has it been a success? It's not an easy contract. We're lucky we have one manager, which is a risk, because we depend on one person, highly capable person called Mary Johns, who knows the contract works well. We make occasional use of a retired former officer who was bringing in on the staff in the 1990s, and that's the only support we provide. We've had to alter the relationship, as I said, 7 out of the 9 schools are academies. It does mean that whole cohorts of children have gone through now the new accommodation, refurbished accommodation, and enjoy the benefits of it. There are some things, if you take the Weatherhead example, which were probably just about acceptable in the 90s, where the pupils used to wander up and down between 3 sites, up and down Mount Pleasant Road, which clearly in today's climate wouldn't be acceptable. So there were some things we'd have to face. But it's not an easy contract. I support Mary in the quarterly meetings. They are challenging because clearly it's a commercial relationship. Behind this are investors who need to make their return, understandably, and it has to be run as a commercial contract. So we're never short of things to have a different view on, but we make it work, really. So I think that's where we are with it, and I'll hopefully try and answer any questions. If I can't answer them, I'll go away and get the answers. Thank you.
Well, just before everyone gets in, and yes, I think the pictures are quite useful to remind us where we came from. I did think that the capital in 2001 was a bit more loose and available.
Yeah.
I was wearing brown and so on, so I thought they'd make capital a little bit more available. However, we felt we had to go down this route. And two things really. In terms of 4.1, and you can do this as a separate thing for me if you like, David. Could you send us a note about what the PFI schools have cost so far, and then what they will cost until we get up to the end of the contract? And the other one, and this is where I clearly sort of lost the plot with regards to Kingsway itself. So, I thought reading 6.8, and we'll talk about Kingsway, that the additional grant that we were receiving to cover Kingsway was in the 5.5 million, listed in 4.1, and that if the total cost was 4.6, by the time the grant reduced, then so you'd see the PFI grant go down and the council contribution go up. But I think from what you were suggesting is if we can't reach some sort of agreement by 2021, that actually the grant will stay the same, but just the council contribution will go up to 1.9 million, is that right? Is that broadly it? Yeah. And we've had to make a 150,000 is still a lot of money, I suppose. So we've had to make a contribution this year from contingency as part of the deal to get the extra money from the government. Is that right?
Okay. I think in terms of, I'll get to the costs so far. Really breaks down into the capital cost of the facilities management.
Yes.
So I'll get you the cost of the end of the contract. In terms of the figures of 4.1, yeah, the 5.5 grant would remain the same per year till 2031. It's been the same throughout the whole period. So clearly the council contribution will go up from the million as we get towards 2031, because there's no inflation on the PFI grant from the government, but there is inflation in the contract minus, I think it's 10% RPI. So the council's contribution will increase towards 2031. And so that's the answer to that one. In terms of Kingsway, yes, the money is additional. It was 1.2 million extra from September 18 to August 21. Said, I don't think they've done it anywhere else, but I think they did eventually accept the argument that it wasn't the council that closed the school. I think it was very much a one-off. I doubt we'll get any more help. But without that, we'd be putting more in this year.
All right.
the members thought it wasn't the way around it and sent for the scheme. Because we then, as again David referred to, had the demise of Jarvis. I think as a governor of a certain school, I went through about 4 years of sheer nightmare, frankly, because things just didn't move, or move very slowly, or completion was delayed, or there were problems with subcontractors. Yes, children's education was disrupted to quite an extent, but it was only the Herculean efforts of staff and commitment from teachers in a number of the schools that did their best to stop that disruption and got the whole cohort of children through. I can remember almost head-in hands meetings with officers at the time about the state of the Jarvis project as it declined. Thankfully, other contractors came along and took the lot over. And I have to say that the buildings now have a regular maintenance programme, upgrading the boilers programme, and to my knowledge, it seems to be successfully modernised. There are still things to do. There is an ongoing anxiety, as I believe I can speak on in general about building bodies, about the costs the schools face for cleaning and other tasks. Because I know that some comparison work was done, and there was a feeling that the schools were being asked, in comparison with what other schools in the authority were paying for contractors, to pay a substantial sum to the current contractors and immediately the past contractors. So I think it just gave us opportunities, but it left us with a legacy of debt, which I'll be grateful to see the figures, because I think the annual audit reports, the 180 odd pages that shares department produced, there are notes about the cost of PFI and how it will continue for future years. On the issue of Kingsway, almost to see this as a millstone that we've inherited, but the pressure to do something about that cost and put someone else in there, putting anyone else in there has to be done on a fair basis after thorough consultation, rather than a rush to get rid of that millstone around our necks.
We asked for it, didn't we? So we did it. So we are the ones who did the planning to say there's going to be enough kids that needs that number of schools at the time, and so on and so forth. So yes, all of you're absolutely right. All of that is true, and it was along with the torches business. I do seem to remember back in the day that I think the company came to. They wanted to put the IT into the thing as well, and the cables, and all that, those browser belt cables and stuff like that. Fortunately, I don't think we didn't put the IT in, did we?
No, they put the cables in.
Yeah, that seems to be cool. Any more for any more? Kath, you indicated anything for over it? No? Okay. Is it Blair and Brown? No.
That's the cost of running the school, really.